And today we're having our session today of understanding the kingdom. This is a question and answer series. So we came together and we just talked about things regarding the kingdom, because we've been preaching it for, I believe, about a good... So since June, so ever since, the Lord kind of brought us into the revelation of the kingdom, which is a message that Jesus preached. Now we want to kind of go kneecap to kneecap, just with the people in the ministry and those that are going to be watching the video afterwards on the web, just to see your questions and your answers and your insights and what you've been getting from hearing, this message. So before we start, we're just going to open up with a word of prayer, and we're going to get rolling. Father God, we just thank you on today, Father God, that we've come together in this place. Lord, we thank you, we praise you, Father God, for you bestowing upon us, Father God, and bringing us into a place of where we're moving forward in your mandate, Father God, for our mankind. Lord, we thank you, we praise you, Father God, that the questions and the answers and the teaching that's going to go forth today, that it comes forth with understanding and answers, questions are answered and answers are given, Father God, to bring forth understanding and revelation to the people. We give you the glory, honor, and praise as me and Pastor Reggie, Father God, decrease so you increase. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yes, sir.
All right. And I just also want to say, praise the Lord, everybody. And I am from Kingdom Ministries International. And I appreciate Pastor Jeremiah as my partner. Pastor Joy, we love you guys so much. And thank God for this message. The Bible says that my people perish for the lack of, if we left that blank, people will put a lot of things in that blank. Like, for the lack of love, my people perish for the lack of food, my people perish for the lack of money, my people perish because of the devil. But the Bible says that his people perish for the lack of knowledge. Very interesting. So what Pastor Jeremiah and I are doing tonight, I think, is revolutionary, almost like a town hall meeting, to see if what we're saying is being received or what's on your mind, and then have some follow-up action afterwards. Right? Amen.
All right, so I'm going to get it going, and I just want to start off with something I believe is going to get the ball rolling here, and I want to pose a question to you all. I want to pose a question to you all. What is it that Jesus preached? Pastor Joy.
He spoke about the kingdom of God.
Okay. What about you, Sister Sid? Or what do you believe with that Jesus preach?
He preached about the kingdom.
About the kingdom?
Of God, yeah.
Okay. Okay. You have a follow-up question?
And you guys, when you have questions, just boom, fall right in. I like this. We're doing something here today. So any question you have, you just go ahead. So you said Jesus preached the kingdom of God.
Right.
Okay? My question is, and you can just say how you feel, why do you believe Jesus preached the kingdom of God message as a priority, or why not? Go ahead.
I believe preached the kingdom because it's full, it has everything in it. Instead of tackling one problem like hunger or like healing someone who's blind, or healing someone who's sick, he preached the kingdom because it has everything in it. It's full. So then, therefore, he doesn't have to lack anything or forget anything because everything's in the kingdom. So I believe that's why he taught the kingdom.
Wow. I believe Pastor Joy had a question as well.
Well, I can answer Pastor Reggie's question first. I believe because, like, what been taught is that earth is an outpost of heaven, so Jesus came to restore man back to God and have us to renew our minds to where we operate on a heavenly level versus a carnal-minded level.
Did you have anything for that, Pastor Reggie?
I like what Sister Sid said. I like what Pastor Joyce said. But my mind thinks in pictures. You said you believe in the kingdom of God message because the kingdom of God has everything right there. Like if it solves the question of hunger. It solves the question of healing. You gave those two examples. So I was thinking about a super Walmart. You can go get shoes. You can go get a battery put in your car. And you can get some eggs and biscuits all in one place. Before there was a super Walmart, you'd have to go to a garage for your battery. You'd have to go to a shoe store for your shoes. You have to go to a grocery store for your groceries. So the kingdom of God is a one-stop shop for the believer. Isn't that convenient? And everybody knows when you buy it at Walmart, it's cheaper. So you get the best for less. Amen? All right.
I want to read this article for you all. And I went to Google. And the website, you know, for this finding is biblicaljesus.org. So www.biblicaljesus.org. And I typed in, what did Jesus preach? And this one was one of the number one websites that popped up. So the topic is, it starts off saying, it says, the gospel Jesus preached. It says, over passing centuries since Jesus lived, traditional Christianity has unfortunately obscured many of the teachings of scriptures. Now, I'm a word guy, so I like to look up, you know, words that, like, you know, I don't really know what they are, so I can understand, you know, what they mean. So let's look up obscured. What does that mean before we go on? So obscured means to not well known, not known to most people. Difficult to understand. That's what obscure means. So I'm going to go back and read that. Over the past 6 centuries since Jesus lived, traditional Christianity has unfortunately obscured, meaning can't understand. Obscure means difficult to understand. So can't understand. Can't understand many of the teachings of Scripture. They can't understand many of the teachings of Scriptures. In some cases, this veiling of certain truths has been deliberate. For instance, in the doctrines of justification and of the Sabbath, while others have been allowed to fade from memory or to be eclipsed by emphasis on other doctrines, the early Roman Catholic Church bears much of the blame for these significant changes, having decreed through their councils that Roman Christianity would follow paths contrary to God's word. And this is the most critical part here. It says, the gospel that Jesus taught during his ministry is one such area that has been purposely diverted from scriptural reality. Ask any nominal Christian what Jesus' gospel was, and the answer is likely to be, he preached a gospel of grace, or perhaps a gospel of salvation. Both of these are correct answers, but not strictly accurate ones. Many Protestants sit in their pews each week and hear a gospel about Jesus himself. This too is not wrong, certainly. Jesus is central to the gospel, but is not exactly what the Bible says it is. And this is a scripture, and we're going to pause here and open up for questions. Mark 1:14-15 provides an inspired answer to our question. And it reads, now after John the Baptist was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of heaven and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.
Can you go back a little bit in the beginning where you talked about the gospel of Christ being obscured intentionally? Is that what you said? The teachings were obscured or hidden intentionally. And what does this article say? By who?
by traditional Christianity. So pretty much by religion and religious leaders of today.
So you mentioned something about the Catholic Church, which was formed about 340 years after the death of Christ and after the death of all the apostles, of the original apostles. The Catholic Church was formed. And you can look that up in the Council of Nicaea and get the whole history on how the universal church was established. In a lot of terms, and what we have today was formed out of the official council meeting, and Constantine being the emperor, and it was made law, because we understand in kingdom, the king, what the king says is law, whether it's right or wrong. So out of that council, they established what they believed to be truth. And a lot of the teachings of the apostles was obscured then, so that's been about 4,000 years. So every single denomination that we have today, grandfather is the Catholic Church. Everyone. The Lutherans, Martin Luther, the only difference between the Lutherans and the Catholics is Martin Luther believed in divorce. He wanted to get married again. The Protestants believed in grace. They were considered protesters, and that name became Protestant. And then they went on down from there. Words like Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit were all officially coined during that council. But since so much time has passed, we take it as truth and not questioning where it really came from.
We have any questions?
Yes, I have a question. What is the take on preaching from the entire Bible?
You want to start off with that, Pastor Reggie?
Your question is, what's the take on preaching the entire Bible? Right? Okay. Well, let's go to Matthew 28, chapter 28. And let's look at verse 20. Jesus was given the formula for baptism in verse 19. Where he says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Verse 20, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. So the Great Commission that Jesus told them to do is to observe all things, okay, whatsoever I commanded you. So we're to teach the priority of God, which is the kingdom of God, and to teach the things that Jesus said that we are to observe, like loving your brother, loving each other, you know, the fruits of the Spirit, all in light and background as what a kingdom citizen should do. As if someone is coming to America to become a naturalized citizen, they will learn. If they come from a country that drives on the left-hand side of the road, we do drive on left or right. We drive on the we drive on the left. Okay. If a person is coming to this country who drove on the left-hand side of the road, as he's becoming an American citizen, he will learn how to drive on the right-hand side of the road. Not just how the government is formed and who's the president and all that stuff. They will learn our laws, as far as school systems and learning our laws, as far as voter registration, how to be a citizen. So let me bring some more light to that. If you look at Acts chapter 28, the last chapter, I think it's verse 30. Acts chapter 28, in verse 30 it says, and Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his hired house, and received all that came unto him, preaching the kingdom of God. See, that's what he preached. and teaching those things which concern Christ. So your question was, what about teaching other things in the Bible? Yes, we are to teach those other things in the Bible as references. Like some people preach out of the Old Testament a lot and only. Well, Jesus said, I came to fulfill the law. I didn't come to destroy it. I fulfilled it. And from that time on, he preached the kingdom of God. So if you're doing anything out of the Old Testament, you're using it as a reference point to bring you to what you should know now. And if anything, we should be preaching, because people want to preach prophecy and the book of Daniel and things of that nature. If you want to preach prophecy, you preach Revelation, because a lot of that stuff ain't happened yet. The stuff in the Old Testament has happened, and some yet to be fulfilled, but we use the Old Testament as a reference. And the last thing is this. The Word of God is like a library. If you want to know science fiction, you don't go into the fiction section. If you want children's books, you don't go into the adult novels. So depending on what you need and what you want, you have to go to the Bible, that part of the Bible, to pull out what you need. How to live in the kingdom is in the New Testament as Jesus demonstrated it. But the examples in the Old Testament gives us examples and references to how we're supposed to live now. All of it's relevant, though, in its proper place. Does that make sense? The Bible talks about grace. It talks about love. But that's not the priority. Once you get the priority set, when you talk about grace and love, then it's in the right context. Does that make sense? All right.
So I want to go a little more in depth, Pastor Joel, with your question. So you asked regarding the Old Testament. Could you repeat it one more time?
I said, is the Bible in its totality, like as a whole, do we teach from the Bible as a whole? Because I've heard people say they only preach from the New Testament, mm-hmm. or they only preach from the Old Testament. But 2 Timothy 3:16 declares that all scripture is inspired by God and is for inspiration, reproof, teaching us holiness, teaching us righteousness. And if the word of God declares in 1 Corinthians, why is Christ put into factions? Oh, I was baptized by Apollos. I was baptized by Paul. I was baptized. I follow Christ only. Why is he put into factions? Why is he divided? I just wanted to know as a whole, if the apostles were filled with the Holy Ghost and given the wisdom of God, then, and if 2 Timothy 3:16 declares that the entire Bible is inspired by God, mm-hmm. for our holiness, for our righteousness, for rebuke, for reproof, for instructions, mm-hmm. then why faction God? Is something that Paul emphasized to the Corinthians. Why is God in factions?
So why have people faction God? Yeah.
Right, so that's what I'm saying. Why do people say, you know, I only follow Christ, I only follow Apollos, I only follow Paul? And that's something he says, is Christ divided? And when it said in 2 Timothy that the whole Bible mm-hmm. is inspired by God,
yeah.
and if God spoke to his men of God and taught them, and why do people divide God? Only Old Testament, only New Testament, only so much. Does that make sense?
It makes sense. And okay. The reason why I believe they do it, and it's not an opinion of mine, is mainly because they don't understand, Sister Sid. They don't understand. So they want to begin to understand what it is that's more plain to them, and then take it from that point on and interpret the way they want to and they desire it. So it's from them not understanding. Go ahead. Me and Pastor Reggie was to have a conversation and he's talking about something that I'm just using a scenario. Maybe that happened way before I came in, you know, to the world or whatever, and I can't understand it. But if he's talking about something present that I can understand, I'll more so take that and run with it, because I don't understand what he was talking about that formally happened. Meaning I would have to take time to meditate on what he's saying, research, you see what I'm saying, begin to understand it, see where it came from, see where the source came from. And I think a lot of believers, they don't want to go back to the source, which is God himself. They don't want to develop a relationship with him. They don't want to begin to get in tune with him to understand the Bible from front to back. So, and that's why Pastor Reggie said the Old Testament, we use it as reference because it helps us to understand what happened in the beginning all the way up until the New Testament moving forward.
I'm going to read you two passages of Scripture. I'm going to get your hand. And then I'm going to explain reference, okay? And there's a something called the first law of reference. Write that down. First law of reference. That means if it happened the first time, like this, ABC, whenever it happens again, whether or not it says ABC, you know that that is how it was done. First law of reference, okay? If scientists discovered 50 years ago a reason for a heart attack, scientists today will use their research based on what was discovered the first time. Okay, like Sir Isaac Newton and the law of gravity. Everything goes back to Sir Isaac Newton when it deals with gravity, because that was the first law of reference proving gravity. Okay, I'm going to read Scripture. I'm not going to say what it is first. I'm just going to read it. I'm going to read it twice. And it shall come to pass after I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days I will pour out my spirit. And it says, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood, fire, and pillars of smoke. Verse 31 is a quote too, but I'll stop right there. Now, listen to this. And it shall come to pass in the last days, said God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall dream dreams. Your old men shall see visions. And on my servants and on my handmaids will I pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I shall show wonders in heaven above and signs on the earth beneath, blood, fire, and vapor and smoke. Sounds the same, doesn't it? The first person that said that was Joel chapter 2, verse 28. When it happened and it was manifested, the apostle Peter said, these are not drunk as you suppose. Acts chapter 2, verse number 14. And Peter, standing at the leaven, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea and all of Jerusalem, be it known unto you and hearken unto my words. These are not drunk as you suppose, but it's the third hour of day. But this is that which is spoken of the prophet Joel. So how did the apostle Peter and the apostles explain the outpouring of the Holy Ghost? He used the Old Testament as reference, and he quoted it verbatim, which is the first law of reference. So when we are preaching in the New Testament, the Old Testament confirms what has been fulfilled, which is applicable today, right? So you have to go to the proper place in the Old Testament to pull out the proper reference. Now, it's priority. First law of reference. Why was the Bible even created in the first place? What was God's point? He had a purpose. Why this word of God is given to us. And Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 says it, that we may have dominion on the earth. God gave us this word because he wants us to have dominion. And we lost dominion, right? And we lost it. And then the first prophecy of the coming of Christ was that the serpent would be bruised, right? That was the first reference to Jesus coming, God speaking to man. So everything in the Bible centers around, I'm coming, I'm coming, I'm coming, I'm here. The kingdom of God is now restored. Go forward in my kingdom. So everything in the Old Testament funnels and leads into the restoration of mankind back to God and his kingdom dominion. And in Revelation, I believe it's chapter 21, it all solidifies because John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth and the new Jerusalem coming down. Bam. Genesis said it. We lost it. The whole process of bringing it forward and solidified in Revelation. That's what the Bible is all about. You can preach Zacchaeus in the sycamore tree, but if it's not tied into God's original purpose, the first law of reference, then you're just talking according to God's priority. Now, when you preach that and when you say that, people get upset, and there's reasons for that. Because if you preach this, you're going to wipe out 80% of the auxiliaries that churches have today and 80% of the meetings that we have. We'll talk about that. That's a whole other topic. If you, when you preach it like this, Mark says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be what? Saved, right? He that believeth not shall be damned. He that believes shall, help me out, they shall do what? They shall speak in new tongues, right? They shall lay hands on the sick, right? If they take up any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Is that a deliverance ministry? See, we've made that deliverance ministry. But who was he talking to? He that believes and is baptized. Everybody. So where did we get having this group of people with a special anointing for deliverance? When Jesus said, every single believer, if you believe and you're baptized, shall lay hands on the sick and then recover. So if you preach this kingdom message in its totality, like you said, Sister Sid, you'll wipe out intercessory teams, because the Bible says pray without what? We all to pray in the Holy Ghost and without understanding, right? That intercessory prayer, that's not just for one group of people. You wipe out the deliverance ministry because everybody's supposed to be able to lay hands on the sick. But people like to be in charge. When you start messing up their program, they get mad. If I'm sick in the hospital and can't talk, and I'm the only one that can cast out a demon, I'm in trouble. I need you, Sister Sid, to be able to get a prayer through if I can't. See, look on your face. Don't that feel empowering that you can hear from God, that he's giving you the Holy Ghost? Preachers who think they own memberships get mad at this message. Ooh.
Sister Sid, you had a question.
It wasn't really a question. I just kind of understood and like the way you guys broke it down.
Mm-hmm.
And what, and it kind of applied to my life, what Pastor Reggie was saying, as far as comparing it to like children books. You won't go into adult section and things like that. And so I do find myself going through certain scriptures to get what I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. Even to the point I might even Google, you know, prayers, you know, something about warfare, so I can just tackle what I'm going through.
Yeah.
And then also, too, you had, yeah, I was talking, what you had mentioned, too, it was what, I know you made that. Okay, I think I'm a little lost for words now.
All right.
Okay. All right.
I'll shut up.
Okay.
when you get that thought, hold the mic and come back. But I want to add on to what you talked about the Old Testament and the question Pastor Joy had about the Old Testament. There was a message that I taught here. It was Keys of the Kingdom, what Jesus preached. You remember? Okay, go ahead. Let's go back to your question.
Okay. Thank you. And also, too, what you had mentioned is that people didn't probably preach the Bible because they don't understand.
Yeah.
And so I do find myself, like, sometimes in Genesis when it's given all the names and stuff, I'm like, okay, like, I didn't get the meaning from it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I will go and maybe bypass it and go to Matthew or go to Psalms to where I'm feeling like I'm getting fed right there.
Yeah.
But I think everything is irrelevant.
Uh-huh.
People do tend to maybe go what they understand.
Yeah.
So I do understand. Right, right.
It is. And we're prone to do that. And that's why Joshua tells us to meditate on this day and night. Meditate. That's what meditation is for. If you look at other cultures and other religions, they have a form of meditation. It's something about when you meditate, it helps you to tap into the very thing that you're needing understanding about. And to regarding the Old Testament, that's good you said that, because what I'm going to talk about next, what Pastor Joy question was, and then what you're talking about, the Old Testament. This is how you study the Old Testament. When you study the Old Testament from Joshua to Malachi, remember that all you're dealing with is the preparation and the announcement for the coming of the king. When you study, I'm going to say it again, when you study the Old Testament from Joshua to Malachi, remember that all you're dealing with is the preparation and the announcement for the coming of the king, the Messiah who is coming to restore what Adam lost. What did Adam lose? The kingdom of God. The dominion of God. That's what the Old Testament is about. When you read Joshua, don't invent prophecies and revelation. When you read Joshua, don't invent prophecies and revelation. It's not directly talking to you, but as you're stating, you don't want to invent anything. When you go to Judges, neither do the same. So you're moving from Joshua next onto the book of Judges. When Jesus was about to leave the earth, he told those guys on the road to Emmaus. He told these guys on the road to Emmaus. He was about to leave the earth, and he walked with them a long time. And the Bible says this in Luke 24, 13 through 35. And I want you to write that down and go read that for the sake of time. Luke 24, 13 through 35. And he was talking to these guys on the road to Emmaus. And we're going to come back the next session and capitalize on that. That means every prophet, every judge, every king had something to do with preparing us for the coming of the king. And I'm going to talk a little bit about judges, and I'm going to pass it on to Pastor Reggie because I feel him boiling. And we're going to start a radio station. I just saw that in the name of Jesus. The Lord just showed it to me. But I'm going to talk about judges. The judges represent righteousness. That's all the book of Judges represent, righteousness. Righteousness is giving someone their rights. Righteousness is giving someone their rights. Deborah was a judge, correct? Esther was a judge. Do you all agree with that? Esther was a judge. She was a form of a judge. Samson was a judge, and I'm going to break it down. These were judges, people who God used to give people their rights. Esther saved a whole group of people who were minorities in a country. Esther saved a whole group of people that were minorities in a country. She was giving them justice. That's why she was a judge. Deborah took over an army and routed an enemy to protect and preserve people who were being abused. That's why she became a judge. What the judges represent, and I'm handing over to Pastor Reggie. It's stated, when the king comes, he will execute righteous judgment. God was using these judges to set up an example for us to see how the king was going to bring justice to the earth. What is justice? Giving people what's rightfully theirs. That's what Christ came to do.
That was, you're my hero. That was powerful. Yeah, we're going to break bread and we're going to swap notes. I'm going to use some of that. So, knowing the Bible as a kingdom book. The problem with the United States, people who have democracies and republics, is they look at Scripture as a democratic book. It's not a democratic book. And if you look at the Bible as a democratic book, you're going to err in Scripture. Because in a democracy, the people have rights. It's okay. In a kingdom, the people don't have rights. As he talked about the judges, the people were being mistreated in the days of Esther. But the people were powerless to do anything about it. They needed a judge. In a democracy, you vote for people who's in charge. You vote for a president. In a kingdom, you don't have a vote. Then the king's word is law. In a democracy, if the people get together and decide this is good and this is law, like abortion and homosexuality, okay, they influence the culture. Now this is law. But in the word of God, what the king says is law with no question. So the Bible is a constitution of a king who has already set law and order, and as the children of the king, our only thing to do is comply. Okay? And we have a hard time in the United States because we want to choose what we want. We want to choose what we believe in the Bible. And you often hear people say, well, I see it this way, and everybody has their own interpretation. That is devilish and not of God. And I can prove that in the book of Matthew, where people refuse to hear the truth. Should I? Okay. If you go to Matthew, what is it? It was chapter 13. And in this chapter, Jesus is talking about the sower and the seed. All right? And the disciples asked him, why do you speak in parables in 13:10? And the disciples came to him and said, why speakest thou in to them in parables? And he answered. It's amazing. Jesus will answer you if you have a question. Jesus answered. Because he said, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but unto them it is not. So what is it saying? Everybody is not going to know the truth. God will allow you to see what you want to see. Okay? God will allow you to see what you want to see. But if you look at verse 15, I'm not going to read a lot, but look at verse 15. Jesus is explaining why he speaks in parables. For this people's heart is what? Waxed gross. It's more than just they don't see it. They have made a conscious effort to harden their heart to truth. Their ears are dull of hearing. They don't want to hear you. That means they are ignoring you. You know how you're talking to somebody? Look at me. Talk to me. Say, Pastor Reggie. Say something else to me. You know I hear you, but my ear is dull of hearing your voice. I ain't listening to you. So that's why Jesus talks in parables. They came for the food and to see the miracles, and they didn't want the heart of God, which is the kingdom of God. So he spoke to them in parables for them to see it and it be revealed to them when they're ready. So look at this, what it says. And their eyes they have closed. My God. Lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart and should be converted and I should heal them. Why are they sick? Because their hearts are waxed gross. They don't want to hear it. Their ears are dull of hearing. They're ignoring you. And when you show them, they have closed their eyes. So they go like this. Okay, Pastor Jeremiah. We did this earlier. So Pastor Jeremiah, show me in the Bible where Jesus said he's only preaching the kingdom of God. So pick up, go ahead, pick it up like you did. See that? He's showing me, but I refuse. My eyes have closed. See, this is why people don't get it, because their hearts are not ready for it. I cannot judge them, but God judges them. I've been preaching since junior high school. Why is it now, 6 months ago, I come into this? Because I had a hunger and a real thirst. And God said, okay, he's ready. I came here and preached for a month, a Sunday, a Wednesday, and a Sunday. Conferred a kingdom onto this brother. Remember standing right there? Boom, he's ready. You're ready. That's why.
But you have a question, Sister Sid.
I have a question for everyone. Okay, go ahead.
But I think you covered it, because I did want you to kind of elaborate on the scripture where he did say it's given to you but not them. So I was kind of like, well, you know, I wanted to hear more about that. Mm-hmm. And then just kind of got the broke down, and I understood, you know, what he meant. It's basically given to everybody, anyone, but those who just refuse it. So even those who refuse it, it's given to them. They just don't want it, you know.
Right.
So I kind of understood it.
Well, what's really interesting is that the Bible only talks about Satan coming when one word is preached. And in that parable of the kingdom, read that chapter 13. When the seed is sown on the path, the wicked one. The Bible only calls the wicked one Satan. When the kingdom of God is preached, the wicked one himself comes. You don't hear that when it's talking about grace, love, speaking in tongues, baptism, because the devil knows God's priority. He was in heaven. He knows God's plan. So when that message is preached, it brings God's people back to dominion power, Satan himself comes. You know? So read chapter 13, Matthew chapter 13, you get that. So here's my question. Did God say we would go to heaven when we die? And if God said it, where? Now, people who are listening on this tape, you can send in your questions to that answer, and I'll really take an honest look at it. So the question is, where do we go when we die? Did God say we'll go live in heaven forever? Because we preach that. On the blissful shores, we'll be with Christ forever in heaven. I can't, you know, song said we'll go to heaven when we die. Did God say preach the gospel of deliverance? If so, where did he say it? Did God say preach the gospel of baptism, Holy Ghost? Okay, go ahead.
I wanted to know what you guys both thought about people who do preach those things. Is it something that no one should preach, or is it, well, what I mean is, should pastors and teachers and those in the forefront teaching other, you know, people to come to Christ or to learn the kingdom, do they teach about healing and having certain people, like they basically will have a day where they say, come to our healing, we're going to have a healing ministry, I guess, and you come and get healed, believe in God to heal you and all of that? Or is it, should it just be preached, teaching people to learn to heal themselves? Do you only teach people to learn and heal themselves and the way how they should do it, or do you give those type of sermons and type of services where you're having a healing service, laying hands and stuff like that. So I want to know, what do you guys think about how people should preach or teach? Is it more of a teaching than a preaching?
Okay, that's a good question, Sister Sid. I want to go to Matthew, I believe it's chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. Starting at verse when he sent the disciples out. I believe it's Matthew chapter 9. One moment. Let me know when you find it, Pastor Reggie. Yeah, here it is, Matthew chapter 10. So Matthew chapter 10, and I'm going to start off at verse 5. And it says, "These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, Go not into the way of the Gentiles." So Jesus told them, Sister said, he said, go not into the way of the Gentiles, because he had a plan for the Gentiles at the appointed time, which he recruited Paul later on, and Paul went into the way of the Gentiles, and that's how we're able to be engrafted into the body of Christ. So he says, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not. So he told them, enter ye not. But he said in verse 6, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and as ye go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So he told them in verse 7, he said, go preaching, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Go preaching, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, meaning at hand, meaning it's here. The kingdom of heaven is here. When you think of the kingdom of heaven and heaven itself, you think of a place that has eternal, everlasting everything, joy, peace, healing, prosperity, success. Then he said in verse 8, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely you give. So he didn't tell them, go preaching a message of deliverance. He didn't tell them, go preach a message of healing or a message of prosperity. Now, what I believe, according to the word, now you do have preachers and teachers and pastors and apostles and bishops that do teach on subjects of healing. I believe that it's good, but it's not the original message. I taught it myself as a pastor and as a minister and as someone, you know, finding my way in the Lord. It helped me to come unto Christ and know of Christ. But it's not the original message. It's not the message that Jesus told us to preach. He told us to preach the gospel of the kingdom of heaven, which the very message that he preached. And regarding your question, adding on to that as well, all throughout our lives, we've been hearing, you know, and been taught, you know, and we've even gone to services that pretty much sectioned everything off. Sectioned everything off, because that's all we knew. So that's all we heard. But when you come into the place of the revelation, and something within you says, there's more to this. There's more to this. And I'm going to use my personal testimony. I've been, just kind of here, established the ministry and been teaching and preaching and coming to church day in and day out. And I've been telling God, there's more to this. There's more to this. And I guess when the Lord saw that my hunger, my appetite, and I had a hunger for more, then he brought me into the place of the kingdom. And he saw that, you know, I can trust you with the kingdom. I can trust you with heaven. I can appoint you an ambassador to direct heaven. Mainly, I can hire you into direct traffic. But it come from me having a hunger for more. Because I said, Lord, you know, I feel like I'm just coming and going, and I'm barely making it as a pastor. And I feel like, you know, I'm teaching the people, I'm feeding the people, but I feel like it's not even keeping them. I'm barely being kept myself. I said, God, there's got to be more. And I told God, sister, said, Lord, if you don't give me more, I'm giving up. If you don't give me more, I'm giving up. And ever since I told God that, sister said, and he revealed to me the gospel, which is the gospel of the kingdom, it's like everything in me, and it's like I feel like nothing is running out. I feel like I will always have something to give to people because I'm given from this everlasting place. I'm giving them this message of this country, this message of this place that's everlasting. And it's so amazing because every time I teach it, every time I preach it, it's like afterwards, I'm still hearing more from God. I literally have to take, like, different books. I think I bought about, like, 10 of these books, and I just continue writing, and things, they just come to me. I don't have to categorize a message, and I don't have to just teach on healing. I just preach the kingdom, and healing just comes. It comes to the people. Oh, it's okay. It just comes, and I'm like, wow, this is amazing. But I feel that everlasting. I feel eternity coming to me. And I tell the people, I'm giving you the kingdom. I don't have anything to give as a pastor because I look as when I was giving from my knowledge and just taking the word at face value, I felt empty afterwards. But now I don't feel empty anymore. You got a question? Go ahead.
Yes, I do have a question. I also wanted to kind of give a small testimony. Is that fine?
No, go ahead.
Okay. I kind of had a similar, I guess, story or background to what you said.
Uh-huh.
And I was like a church goer. I wasn't raised in the church.
Uh-huh.
Different family members took me to church, and then as I grew up, I just wanted to be in church. But I was always conflicted.
Mm-hmm.
In my spirit, I was conflicted. And so as I got older and I was like, I need to find a church home. I need to figure this out. Even though I'm conflicted,
mm-hmm.
I said, I feel like I relate to Christians. I'm just going to go towards that.
Yeah.
And I just took what I wanted to take and certain things. If I didn't want to say it, if I felt uncomfortable, I just wouldn't say it. I let it, the whole church say it. And so, you know, the Lord led me to go to the home church.
Yeah.
And I went there, I don't know if it was 2 times or 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those times he announced you were going to open a church. And, you know, something in me said, you know, join that church. Just join it. And
yeah.
So I'm like, all right, I'm joining that church. He's on fire. I can tell. And as I was coming, and then when you guys started preaching the kingdom, I just felt so at peace. Like, I was missing something, but now I'm like, I can move forward.
Yes.
Because I'm building myself. It's not so much where I'm like, oh, I got to call my pastor, which I know because I'll call you guys. You know, but it's not so much, let me just call them. If I do, maybe it's for advice or let's go over the Bible or something like that. Let me get clarity. Instead of calling because, oh, I need this prayer so much. I need this healing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going through this. But it's a teaching of, okay, you need to heal yourself.
Tap
out of it. You're right. You got the kingdom. You got dominion. Move forward.
Mm-hmm.
But thank you. My question actually was kind of towards what you're reading with the scripture.
Mm-hmm.
And what I got from it was teach the kingdom. And then do. Is mm-hmm. that what I kind of see? Do the healing.
That's right.
But you don't have to have a service about healing.
Exactly.
Go heal.
Uh-huh.
Teach someone else, they go heal.
Exactly.
So that's what I got, and that sounds good.
Wow, that's amazing. I want to hit on one more thing. I'm going to have Pastor Reggie. I know he has something, and he's going to close us out. So I'm going to hit on one thing you said and hit on that, and then you can take it from there and close it out. Pastor Reggie earlier talked about democracy. Why we in the United States don't understand because we have a democratic mind. Democracy is a form of government in which people choose leaders by voting. It's a country ruled by democracy, or it's an organization or situation in which everyone is treated equally, has equal rights. Meaning, like what Pastor Reggie said, people control everything. We don't submit ourselves up under a governmental kingdom, which is the kingdom of heaven. Somebody yesterday asked me, they said, man, I hear you're not calling yourself a Christian anymore. I said, no. I said, I am a kingdom. I'm a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. I am a law-abiding citizen. And I want to break that down. I think Sunday I told everybody, go back and watch that movie, Law-Abiding Citizen. And you'll understand what I'm talking about. I am a law-abiding citizen. Meaning, I'm going to use John chapters 15, 1-7, it talks about I am the true vine. It says, if I abide in him and he abide in me. When I say I am a law-abiding citizen, I am abiding in his law, his word, this legal document, and he is abiding in me, and I am a citizen of his kingdom. So I am a law-abiding citizen of the kingdom of heaven. So I said, no, I'm not a Christian, because that title has been so tainted and perverted, and when the world, the people in the world hear that, they don't think of they don't think of Christ. They don't think of purity. They don't think of holiness. They think of every other thing outside of God. People think of, oh, I've been church hurt by Christians. I've been church hurt. So I told the young man, I said, man, I'm a law-abiding citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And it intrigued him. He's like, what is that? And I said, I'm glad you asked. And I began to minister to the young man. And it was amazing how I was able to witness to him and minister to him. It actually stirred up something in him to want to know more about, okay, this kingdom of God. So I tell people, man, I'm a law-abiding citizen of the kingdom of heaven. This is the law that I'm sticking by, the document that I'm sticking by, and I'm a citizen abiding in this word, which is keeping me in this kingdom, so I can inherit everything in the kingdom. So and then what you said, that message, it helps us to understand what Jesus preached and what we ought to continue to preach. We don't have to section everything off. We don't have to, like Pastor Joy said, people were confused when they say, I follow Apollos and this and that. That's why Jesus said to preach this message, so it won't bring about confusion. But I'm going to close out there, and I'm going to have Pastor Reggie give what he has to say and close us out.
All right. That was awesome. And I really love that you guys came out. And we're going to do this again. I want to piggyback a little bit on the Christian thing. www.ecclesical.org/truth/christians.html, or you can Google why we call ourselves Christians by Richard Anthony. You can look at it, why should we call ourselves Christians, or look up Richard Anthony. Listen very carefully. How and when was the word Christian first used? The term Christian was used to describe the followers of Christ in terms of the world, and from the world's point of view, write that down. Pagans at Antioch called the apostles Christians first. Acts chapter 11, verse 26 and 28. And used it derogatorily, write that down, because the apostles did not follow the commercial world of pagans. They were called Christians as a derogatory thing because they wasn't following the status quo of pagan. Pagan means religious. They serve gods. They are very, very loyal to their gods. They bring food to their gods. They sing songs to their gods. They make sacrifices to their gods. But those apostles, them Jesus-following folk, they ain't doing it the way we do it. So what do we do in the world today when somebody ain't following the status quo? What do high school kids do to the girl who don't have their hair like the rest of the girls? They think of all kind of nasty names for her. And that's where that word came from. Let me continue. Christians is an adjective, not a noun. The substance is not in the word Christian. The substance is in the heart of the man that is attempting to describe, which the pagan used and the pagans could not see. Okay? Second paragraph, this last one. This goes on many pages, but I'm going to read this. Christ, write this down, Christ never called himself a Christian. Christ never called his followers Christians. The apostles never called each other Christians. Christ never used an adjective to describe himself. So how are we identify ourselves then? How do we identify ourselves? The disciples called each other, write this down, brethren, disciples, apostles, servants, believers, followers, the faithful, the elect, the called, the saints. We can also identify ourselves as bond servants of Christ. No one ever used that word Christian except for the pagans who hated you. It's mentioned only 3 times in the Bible. 2 by pagans and 1 by the Apostle Paul. Saying if they're going to call you a pagan, be a good one. If they're going to call you a Christian, be a good one. As unto God. He never called you that. He called you sons of God. He called you a royal priesthood, a holy nation. That's like calling me, I'm going to use the word because it's applicable. Calling me a nigger. And then 4,000 years pass, so I'm going to call myself a nigger. And call it a good thing. Knucklehead, that word in any century is not working for me. Calling us a Christian is like calling us niggers. Coon, jungle bunny, big lip, watermelon eating, barefoot spear chucker. Not cool. I am not going to allow the world to define this child of God. I'm not going to let the world define this Lord of this earth. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords walking at authority. Come on. Now, what do you call the man that sells out to the man and he tap dancing with a black face and big lips? Jingle Bojangles. I'm not your Jingle Bojangles in God. I am a royal priesthood and a holy nation. All right, so wrapping this up. You're right. Preach the kingdom of God, then heal. Jesus said nothing about no healing ministries, deliverance ministries, intercessory prayer teams. Get together once a month and go witness for 1 hour. Okay? You are a female 24/7. You don't stop being a woman. You're a woman 1 day a week on Saturday, the first Saturday of the month for 2 hours. No, you're a woman. You act like a woman. You walk like a woman. You are a child of God every single day of the week. You are a light. You are salt every day. Yep. So you're right.